Thank you, Chris. Good afternoon. Today, we'll be providing you with preliminary information and details of what led up to the officer-involved shooting and death of Raymond Calderon on Wednesday, June 22nd, in the 1400 block of Bendorf Drive in South San Jose. Several incidents, including two homicides, preceded the officer-involved shooting. On Tuesday, June 21st, at approximately 4:35 p.m., a woman called and reported that her ex-boyfriend, Raymond Calderon, with whom she has two children in common, was violating a peaceful contact restraining order and was also making threats to kill his, Calderon's, grandmother. The two children, ages 6 and 7, were with suspect Calderon as he made the calls to her. Calderon also made comments over the phone to the woman, indicating that he wanted to commit suicide. Officers responded to the ex-girlfriend's residence to investigate the restraining order violations and the threats. A records check revealed that Calderon had an outstanding warrant for his arrest for violating a restraining order against this same woman. Officers initiated a Be on the Lookout broadcast citywide for the wanted suspect and also initiated a welfare check for the two young children and the grandmother. Officers then went to Calderon's residence in the 6,000 block of Monterey Road in an attempt to locate Calderon. However, he was not at the residence. At approximately 7:11 p.m., officers responded to a shooting in the 1400 block of Mount Shasta Drive in East San Jose. When they arrived, they found an adult male who was shot multiple times on the ground. The victim was transported to a local hospital where he was pronounced deceased. Witnesses at the scene who knew Calderon identified Calderon as a suspect in that homicide. During the homicide investigation, witnesses also described Calderon fleeing in a red Ford F-150 with an unknown occupant. Calderon was now wanted for the restraining violation and the homicide. Officers then updated the BOL with this new information. Officers then learned that Calderon's grandmother was in contact with the ex-girlfriend who initially called the department and that she and the two children were the suspect, Calderon. Due to safety concerns for the ex-girlfriend, she was then transported to the police department as officers searched for suspect Calderon. Officers were then advised that Calderon had a girlfriend in the city of Modesto. Officers requested that the Modesto Police Department conduct a welfare check on the girlfriend. Modesto police advised us that they were currently investigating a homicide with a female victim and that the victim had a child in common with Calderon. The Modesto homicide occurred at 9:20 p.m. and the primary suspect in that homicide was determined to be Calderon. We quickly mobilized additional investigative resources to locate and apprehend suspect Calderon. At 11:48 p.m., our police helicopter located the red F-150 truck driving southbound on Highway 101. The truck continued to drive southbound at a high rate of speed and eventually left the city limits. The California Highway Patrol assisted and pursued the vehicle as it continued southbound, and a few minutes after midnight, the suspect exited the freeway in Gilroy. Suspect Calderon had a female and two children exit the vehicle and onto a residential street. CHP contacted the subjects left behind by suspect Calderon and determined the female was Calderon's grandmother and Calderon's two children. Calderon's grandmother had two black eyes and stated that she was pistol whipped by Calderon. Calderon then drove back onto Highway 101 and proceeded north toward San Jose. He then reached South San Jose and began driving on surface streets. Our officers re-engaged in the pursuit and followed him through various parts of South San Jose and eventually in the area of Round Table and Bendorf Drives. He then abandoned his truck while it was still in motion in the area of Bendorf and Round Table and fled on foot. He then ran into the backyard of a residence and fired several rounds at five officers who were following him on foot. The officers took cover behind vehicles and residences to avoid being hit by the suspect's gunshots. The suspect then attempted to forcibly enter several homes in the neighborhood, but was unable to enter them. Calderon then found and entered an unoccupied shed to the rear of a residence on Bendorf Drive. Officers quickly established a perimeter and contained the suspect. As a result of the ongoing and immediate public threat, nearby residents were evacuated, and a full special operations callback was initiated to respond to this now barricaded, armed, and dangerous suspect. Tactical negotiators attempted to contact the suspect, making numerous attempts to engage him in conversation via cell phone and loudspeaker. None of these attempts were successful. And also during this time, the barricaded suspect fired several more rounds. After 7 hours of unsuccessful attempts at establishing communication, tear gas was introduced into the shed. At approximately 7:22 a.m., the suspect ran out of the shed and raced toward the perimeter officers. The suspect was observed with a gun in his right hand and was given several commands to drop the gun. Calderon ran towards officers surrounding the house and raised and pointed the gun at Special Operations Officer. Two officers fired their weapons at the suspect, striking him twice. The suspect fell to the ground with the gun near him, and a canine officer deployed his canine to separate the suspect from the gun. Life-saving measures were then administered by an on-scene tactical paramedic. Calderon was transported by ambulance to the local hospital where he was pronounced deceased. Evidence technicians recovered two firearms at the scene, the one Calderon was holding and another near the shed. In addition to the two firearms, multiple empty shell casings were found. Both handguns were determined to be stolen. Suspect Calderon senselessly killed two people, and when finally confronted by the San Jose Police Department in a highly populated neighborhood, he opened fire on them as a last-ditch effort to escape. This endangered not only the pursuing officers, but innocent members of our community. Calderon's actions drove the events and outcome of this tragic incident. Our officers acted with tremendous bravery and placed their lives in danger to protect the community from any further harm and arrest this violent suspect. I am grateful that we are not here today talking about an officer being shot or killed. Their safety, as well as the community's safety and well-being, are always in my thoughts and prayers. I want to extend my deepest condolences to the families of the victims, not just here in San Jose, but in Modesto as well, affected by this tragic series of events. This includes the family of Raymond Calderon. There were two involved officers in this shooting. The first has 27 years of experience, and the second has 6 years. Both are members of our Special Operations Unit. Both officers were equipped with body-worn cameras that were activated during the incident. Both officers have been placed on routine administrative leave, and their names will be released at a later date in compliance with state law. A joint criminal investigation by the Santa Clara District Attorney's Office, the San Jose Police Department's homicide unit, is underway. The case is being monitored by the San Jose Police Department's Internal Affairs Unit, the City Attorney's Office, and the Office of the Independent Police Auditor. The determination whether this shooting was lawful and justified will come from the District Attorney at a later date. And as with all officer-involved shootings, we will be releasing a community briefing video of body-worn camera footage in the coming weeks, dictated by AB 748. Calderon is a San Jose resident. He was prohibited from possessing any firearms due to prior felony and domestic violence convictions. And I will turn it over to Mayor Liccardo.
Thank you, Chief Mata. I'll be very brief. I applaud the patient and courageous efforts of San Jose police officers that prevented Raymond Calderon from inflicting an even more horrific toll than the two lives he had already taken in the 24 hours before this incident. Mr. Calderon had killed two victims in a matter of hours, and when pursued by San Jose police officers, fired several rounds as he was being pursued and ultimately as he barricaded himself. Despite several hours of diligently seeking to encourage the suspect to drop the gun, the officers encountered a suspect who was sprinting toward them, firing additional shots at them. We would all like these encounters to result in the arrest of an individual without further harm. But I think we all know that's not always possible, and certainly not in this case. My prayers are with all the families devastated by this terrible tragedy, including Mr. Calderon's.
We're going to play some slides while Captain Dwyer comes up to answer any questions you may have, including a photo of the suspect and firearm use.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Captain Jason Dwyer from the San Jose Police Department's Bureau of Investigations. What you're going to see here on the first slide is a still photo that we'll follow with a slow motion video, and that's basically does look a little cloudy. That's actually a chemical agent floating in the air. And what you'll see next is the suspect exiting that shed, and he has a handgun in his right hand. Here it is at 50% speed, and you can clearly see he's got a black semi-auto pistol in his right hand. And in the next slide, this is an arrest photo of our suspect, Raymond Calderon. And in our next slide, here is a still photo of suspect Calderon, again with the pistol in his right hand. And again, he does not obviously appear to be attempting to discard that pistol in any way. In the next slide, there is a up-close photo. As the chief alluded to, there were multiple firearms found at the scene. This was the pistol that our suspect was armed with during the deadly force encounter, and the gun that he was armed with when he fled the shed. It is a stolen, serialized firearm with a high-capacity magazine.
I'll send you guys all these photos and
and I'll open it to any questions you may have.
Do we know the relationship between Mr. Calderon and the first suspect, the first victim that was killed here in San Jose,
The male victim on Mount Shasta, the motive of that homicide remains under investigation. We do know that they were known to each other. As for the content of that final conversation, it remains under investigation. So right now, we do not know 100% what the motive was.
And the two children were in the car at the time he drove from the death zone back.
So as the chief alluded to earlier, this event started earlier with a domestic violence restraining order violation. The mother was reporting that the father had not returned the kids in accordance with a court order, and was also making threats over the phone. So we believed at that point that the children were still with him. We believe the children were there on Mount Shasta, and unfortunately saw this tragic event unfold.
So as far as you know at this point, he had the children in his car as approved by a court or some warrant. It wasn't the kidnapping of his kids from
his I think that that's a difficult question. I will offer that, you know, it becomes in violation of a court order as soon as you commit a homicide in front of your children. That's an automatic game changer. So. Unfortunately, this just goes to speak to not only how ruthless and violent this individual was in committing the homicides that the chief mentioned earlier, but the extreme indifference to lives he may affect years from now. I mean, these children may be affected by this for the rest of their lives, and hopefully they get the support that they need and the love that they need to thrive. But I can't imagine, being a father, I can't imagine what it would be like to witness the things that these children witnessed during this series of events.
One last question. The woman who was killed in Modesto, she was the mother of the child who was not in the vehicle.
I don't believe. Can you answer that?
They have a separate child together, from what I understand, less than 1 year old.
Okay.
Who was not with Calderon at any time.
Okay. So the child of the person in Modesto was not in the vehicle at no time in the vehicle.
That's what I understand. Correct.
Apologize. I didn't want to misspeak on that.
So was the understanding that Mr. Calderon brought his grandmother and his two children to Mount Shasta? They stayed in the truck. You know, kind of got out. Do we know what preceded the first shooting? Was it an argument, conversation? Did it happen out in the street?
What we can tell you is that there was some conflict, obviously, between the suspect and the victim in this case. We do believe both children and the grandmother were in the car at the time. And obviously, there was a very violent homicide that was committed right in front of these three family members. And so, you know, when we respond to a case like this, we have to not only look at solving the homicide, trying to locate and arrest the suspect, but to the question that was asked earlier about the kidnapping, we treat them as if they're being held against their will at that point. These are 6 and 7 year old children. They don't have a choice on whether or not they want to be in the back of that truck. They don't have a choice on whether or not they'd like to or understand what the suspect's doing. And so we had multiple priorities. We threw a lot of investigative resources at this, basically all of them that we had at the time. Not only because we believed at a certain point that we were dealing with two homicides, but we were trying to locate both the children and the grandmother, hopefully safely.
Good.